Hello everyone, in today's class we are going to study about the theorem related to the concatenation and reversal of strings. We are going to see the relations on strings, we are going to learn what are languages and the different functions which can be applied on a language. So first we'll move ahead and see the theorem related to the concatenation and reversal of strings. So now we'll look into the theorem, that is nothing but concatenation and reverse of the strings, and we'll see what identity is applicable on the concatenation and reversal of strings. So if W and X are two different strings, W concatenated with X, the old reverse is equal to X reverse W reverse, that is nothing but the reverse applied on individual X and Y, X and W, the reverse applied individually on X and W, but in the reverse order. So we'll see this with an example and check whether it works or not, and then we will try to prove it by the identities that we know. So name tag is one word. This can be divided into W and X. So W X whole reverse. So the name tag whole reverse is equal to tag reverse concatenated with name reverse. So this is a substitution for X and this is a substitution for W. So once we do this, reverse of tag we get GAT and reverse of name we are going to get EMAN. So once you check this original word and the last conclusion that we have got from the identity, we have seen that the entire W, if you consider name tag as one single string, is reversed here. So name tag has changed to gate man. Now by induction we'll have to prove the theorem. So we'll take up the element that is nothing but the length of X. So first step, what we'll do in the base case is consider that X is 0. So that means the length of X is 0. In case any string's length is 0, we have to know that it is a epsilon. So it will not have any character at all in it, and therefore the string itself is epsilon that we are going to consider. So we'll take up the same identity and resolve it. So WX whole to the power of R. So we'll try to prove it by the induction. We'll pick up WX whole to the power of R. So we know that the string X is epsilon. Therefore we can write this as W epsilon whole to the power of R. So we know that epsilon is the identity of concatenation. Therefore, if we append epsilon either towards the right side or towards the left side, the original string will not change. Therefore, this can be written as W to the power of R. Also, we may write the same thing as epsilon W whole to the power of R. So we are not changing the meaning again. So WR can also be written as epsilon W whole to the power of R. So here, this is equal to epsilon to the power of R and W to the power of R. So epsilon to the power of R. So now we replace epsilon by X because X is equal to epsilon. So X reverse and W reverse. So this is what we are going to prove. So next case, we'll take up any X whose length is either N or N plus 1. So this has to apply for every string other than epsilon also. That means any string which has got at least one character or more characters. So for that we'll consider a string X, and length of X is considered to be n plus 1. So it has the length some n plus 1 character. Therefore X can be broken down into two things. So X can also be written as U and A. So in previous class when we studied about strings, we have divided one string into two parts, that is A being the last character of the string and U being the rest of the string which is preceding this last character. So X can definitely be divided into U and A. So U belongs to sigma star and A belongs to sigma, a single symbol. So once we have done this, we'll move on. We'll take the LHS WX whole to the power of R is equal to W. X has been split up into U and A. Therefore, instead of X, we have written UA and whole to the power of R remains the same. So we know that concatenation is associative. So here we are going to use the property associativity of concatenation. So once we use the associativity of concatenation, so W, U, interchanging of these brackets is not going to change the meaning of concatenation. So once we have done this, this whole thing can be treated as U and this can be treated as a single symbol A. Therefore, by using the identity of reversal that we have seen in the previous class, so U A whole to the power of R is equal to A U to the power of R. So this can also be written as A. So the last character is coming to the beginning and we take the reverse of the rest of the strings here to have the same effect. So we are doing this here. Then we have the identity already, WX whole to the power of R. So WX whole to the power of R is equal to UR WR. So this is how we are going to change it using the indication hypothesis. So after we have done this, again we are going to use the associativity property of concatenation. So we are going to combine these two concatenated with WR. Again, it does not change any meaning because concatenation is associative. So once we have done this, again we have the reversal. We have the, again we have the identity of reversal. So A U whole to the power of R can be written as U A whole to the power of R W R. U A is nothing but what we split up X into. Therefore, we can write U A as X. So therefore, X to the power of R W to the power of R. And hence, we have proved that when you have two strings combined together and we want the reverse, is equal to individual strings interchanged by position and taking the reverse on each of them. So this identity holds good when we combine the concatenation and reversal of strings. Now we will move ahead to see what are the different relations that can be applied to strings. So first thing, we have to know what is a subset of a string. Second, what is a proper subset of a string? What is a suffix? What is a prefix? So associated with suffix and prefix, we will have proper suffix and proper prefix. So we'll take up an example and study each one of them while we also define them. So first of all, what do you mean by a subset? So given, so we'll take up the first one, that is nothing but defining what is a subset. Given any two strings, S and T. The string S is a subset of string T only if S completely occurs continuously in T. So therefore, if you take up an example of a string where W is equal to COLLEGE, and we'll see various substrings that are that belong to this. We'll see what are the different substrings that belong to this college. So COL. So we can see that COL, three characters are appearing continuously in the string T. Therefore, COL is a substring. Therefore, COL is a substring of college. So then we take up LEG. So we'll see whether L followed by E followed by G is present in this string. So we can see that L, E, G are appearing continuously inside the string. Therefore, LEG is also a substring. Next, we take up LOG. So LOG, and we're going to check whether LOG is a substring of college. LOG. So nowhere we can find LOG appearing together in the string. Therefore, this is not a subset of college. Next, we'll take up COLLEGE itself and see whether this can be present in the entire string. So we can see all the alphabets are appearing continuously in the string, and therefore college is also a substring of W. So now that we have known what are substrings, we are going to understand what is a proper substring. So the proper substring also satisfies the condition where given S and T, S should be present in T continuously, but it should also satisfy that S is not equal to T. Therefore, the subset what we are looking for in the original string T, both of them should not be equal. There should not be exact match in characters between S and T. So this is nothing but a proper subset. So when we take up all these S that we have found out in T, so we can see that here COL is not equal to college. So therefore, COL is a proper subset. LEG is not entirely equal to the string, therefore LEG is also a proper subset. LOG is neither a subset nor a proper subset. COLLEGE. So when we take up this, so S is equal to T. So this satisfies S is equal to T. Therefore, only college is the string that is not a proper subset. So the rest of them are all proper subsets except LOG. So this is the indication of what is a subset and what is a proper subset. So next we will move ahead and see what is a suffix of a string. Now given two strings, suppose there are two strings S and T. S is a suffix of T only if T can be represented as X followed by S for some X that belongs to sigma star. So therefore, S, which is a suffix of any string, should appear at the end of the string, and there should be at least some elements preceding that suffix. So suppose if you take up the example string as ABB, so the suffix of the string ABB are B, BB and ABB. So B can be treated as a suffix because we have some elements which are before this S. Then BB can also be treated as a suffix because at least we have one character, that is A, that belongs to this X. ABB is a suffix, imagining that we have a epsilon here. So therefore, ABB is also a suffix. Also imagining that there is one epsilon towards the end of the string, epsilon is also treated to be the suffix of this string. So we know that epsilon is the identity of concatenation. Therefore, it doesn't make any difference to the string if you imagine either an epsilon towards the right, left, or anywhere in between the strings. So therefore, these are the set of the suffix for the string ABB. Now, let's go to the understanding of what is a proper suffix. So every property that is satisfied by a suffix should also be satisfied by a proper suffix. And along with that, it should also satisfy the property of S is not equal to T. So therefore, the suffix that you are going to look at should not be equal to the original string. Therefore, if you look at the examples here, we have the suffix B, we have suffix BB, and we have suffix ABB, and we have epsilon. So if you look at the list here, S, which is B, is not equal to ABB. BB is not again equal to ABB. ABB is equal to ABB. So this is the condition that satisfies S is equal to T. So therefore, this entire string is not going to be considered as the proper suffix. So the rest are going to become the proper suffix of the string ABB. Next, we'll learn what is a prefix. So the word pre means something that comes before. So therefore, we are looking for some string that comes before something. So therefore, if S and T are taken to be two strings, while S is the prefix and T is the original string. So therefore, S, which is nothing but the prefix, which has to be the prefix, has to come before some elements of the original string. So T together is made up of S and X. So therefore, S is some part of the string that comes before another part of the string. So therefore, this is called as the prefix. Also, X belongs to sigma star. That means X is a string. So we have seen in the previous classes what is sigma star. So sigma star can be defined as, it is the union of sigma to the power of 0 up to sigma to the power of infinity. It is a infinite set. We'll take up the same example ABB, and we will find out what are the prefix of the string ABB. So A is a prefix of ABB. Imagining that epsilon was here, epsilon is also a prefix of ABB. Then next we have AB, which is a prefix. So therefore, this part which appears before this B, so AB is also treated to be a prefix. And after that, we have ABB as one of the prefix, imagining that we have the element epsilon here. So these are the different prefix of ABB. So once we have these prefix, we will go and see what is a proper prefix. Just like what we studied in the proper suffix, all the properties that has to be satisfied by a prefix has to be satisfied by a proper prefix also. And along with that, it should also satisfy the condition that the prefix that we are looking for should not be equal and exact match to the original string. Therefore, taking up the same example, A can be a proper prefix, epsilon can be a proper prefix, AB can also be a proper prefix, but ABB, which is a subset, rather ABB, which is a prefix, is exactly equal to the original string. Therefore, ABB will not be included here in the proper prefix, since it does not satisfy the condition S not equal to T. So these are the different relationships that can be applied on the strings. So next, we will move ahead to see what is a language, and we'll see several things that we have to know about a language, and we'll see how to define a language. So first of all, we have studied what are strings. So strings are nothing but a sequence of symbols chosen from some alphabet. So in the previous class, we have taken example of a binary alphabet, and we have also taken the example of a English alphabet. So from the binary alphabet, which includes only the symbols 0, 1, we have framed a sequence of symbols. We call them as strings, such as 0, 1, 1 is a string, and also 1, 0, 0 is also a string. So now, once we know the concept of strings, we can frame what is called as a language. A language is a collection of strings. Strings being the collection of symbols, language being the collection of strings. So therefore, formally we can define languages as, a language is a finite or infinite set of strings over a finite alphabet sigma. So we know that this alphabet is always a finite set. So we have well defined the number of symbols inside sigma. But when we start framing the strings which are possible from that sigma, it could lead either to a finite or to an infinite set, and that set is called as a language. Suppose we have sigma is equal to A, B. So we can start framing the different strings which are possible from A, B. So we can call that set as sigma star. And we can start framing the string starting from picking up 0 symbols at a time. Then we have picking up 1 symbol at a time, then 2 at a time, and also 3 at a time, and so on. So these are all possible sets of strings, and it is denoted by sigma star. So any language L could be sum of the strings which are there inside the sigma star. So I'll define the first language L1 and I put few strings from here into it. So therefore it becomes the language L1 and it is a set of strings. So L2 can be AB, BBB, AAA, etc. So L2 again is a collection or a set of strings. So when we look up L1 and L2, we have not put any constraints on the set of the strings that will be included within the set. So this is random set of strings which we have put into L1 and L2. There is also possibility that we put a constraint on what strings go into L1 and what don't, and that is how we write another way of defining the language L. Suppose we have the statement, in the strings of A's and B's, all the A's precede all the B's. So once we have the statement all A's precede all B's, we have to understand that the alphabet here is A comma B, because the string is made up of A's and B's. So therefore sigma is equal to A comma B. So how do we define how the language and put a, how do we define what is the constraint that tells A's precede all B's? So we can write the definition of a language as L is equal to W. And we now start writing something about the W that has to be satisfied. So W is a string and it should belong to the language. We include what is actually required from W. So we write here all A's precede all B's. So now we are writing the string W and we put a colon and write something about W. So this is a well-formed language which has got a clear indication of what has to be included within the language. So next we'll see another definition very similar to the previous one. We are defining L and L should include a string X and the X should satisfy the constraint whatever is given following the colon. So the constraint given is, there is a string Y, there exists Y that belongs to A comma B star. So once we say A comma B star, we should understand that Y is made up of A's and B's. And also X should be in the form of Y followed by a A. So what we understand from this is A should always be the last symbol in the string, always. And Y can be anything that includes A comma B, any number of times. So therefore the set of the strings that could be in this language are A, B, A. So we can see that it is ending with a A and hence it is. Now the set of strings that are included within L are, L is equal to A, B, A. So as long as we see that A is present as the last character, it belongs to the language. AA is another string that could be belonging to the language. Then just the A is another string, considering Y as epsilon in this case. So this can be divided into Y, which is made up of A's and B's, and this is A. So this is Y and this is A. So this is Y and this is A. This Y is epsilon. So this list is endless and therefore we write the symbol to indicate that the entire list is an infinite set. Next we move on to learning what is an empty language. So this language has got certain elements within it. In case we don't have any elements within the language, that language is called as an empty language. So therefore an empty language is represented as L is equal to, and we do not write any element within the brackets, just like how we represent an empty set, or else we write L is equal to phi. So both the notations are used to denote a empty language. Now L is equal to epsilon cannot be same as a empty language. So we know that epsilon is an empty string, but the language contains at least one element, that is an epsilon, and therefore cannot be treated as empty. So this is a language that contains a single string, and that string is a epsilon. So these two are not the same. Next, we can also use another type of representation, and we are generating the elements of the language. So once we start generating the elements of the language, we use the, when we want to generate the elements in the language, we are using replication to form the strings that belong to the language. One such example is L is equal to a to the power of n, where n is greater than or equal to 0. So this form of a language is called as a language generator, because it's going to replicate something and start forming the strings. So the language L will consist of the strings epsilon. Epsilon is taken because n can also be equal to 0. So we have to remember the replication of strings concept here. So a to the power of n, so it replicates the same string that many times, and this is indicated by n in this case. So n is greater than or equal to 0. So once it is equal to 0, it becomes an epsilon. When it is equal to 1, it becomes a single a, and then we form 2a's, 3a's, 4a's, and so on up to infinity. So now we are generating the list by satisfying the condition what is given in the language definition. So language is a set, and therefore the language has to be specified if it is a language generator or a language recognizer. The language generator is the one that is going to form the strings or enumerate the strings which will be in the language, and a language recognizer is going to pick up the constraint on the string and check whether the string belongs to the language or not. It returns either true or false. So here we have seen two examples. We'll take up the first example, and we are putting a constraint on x saying that it has to have some string before it ends with a a. Therefore, it's going to pick up the strings and check whether each one of them is ending with a a, and it is going to say true or false, that is whether the string belongs to the language or not. Next, we have another example here in the fifth point. We have a to the power of n, where n is greater than or equal to 0. So this is the case where the language is defined as a language generator, because a to the power of n is the one which is generating the set of sequence here. So talking about the language generators, which enumerates the list of strings that belong to the language, we can put a lexicographic order, and it is denoted by the total order D, where when we are interested about the formation, when we are interested about the formation of the strings, and we are also concerned about in what order the strings are generated, we are going to put the constraint of this lexicographic order. So the lexicographic order works in two ways. The lexicographic order states that all the elements inside the language will be assigned or will be arranged. All the elements within the language are going to be arranged in the ascending order of their lengths. Therefore, we start from the smallest length string going forward, generating the larger strings. And also, when we take up any string that is of equal length, they have to be ordered in the alphabetical order. So these two constraints are satisfied when we provide a lexicographic order. So now we'll see an example here. We have L is equal to x that belongs to a comma b star. So this states that x is made up of a's and b's. We also have a constraint here saying that all a's should precede all b's. And we'll try to frame the strings which are there in this language by also following the lexicographic order. So now the strings that belong to the language are L is equal to epsilon, which is the smallest string and its length is 0. Next we have string of length 1. So this is the part where we have strings of length 1. Each one of them have got equal length, therefore they are ordered in the alphabetical order. Next, we have strings of length 2, but here we have the constraint all A's precede all B's. So the length 2 strings possible are AA, AB, BA and BB. So we do not write this BA in the language because it does not belong to the constraint. So BA is never added here because all A's have to precede all the B's. And also see that we have all the strings here in this block where each of them has got the length 2, and also see that they are arranged in the alphabetical order. In case we are dealing with numbers where the strings are made up of integers, then they will be arranged in the ascending order of numbers. In the next class, we are going to study about the functions which can be applied on languages.